around the corner or around the world with the Green Up Beacon.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back. This is the Green Up Beacon Video News Magazine, Tri-State's longest running online magazine. And our very special guest today and my personal enemy is Jim Waters of the Bluegrass Institute. And there's some beacon involved in your name, right?
Well, the column that we send out weekly is beacon. My column, my Bluegrass Beacon column.
And he's blamed me for 10 years.
Yeah,
for stealing his name. But guess what? Maryland picked it, Jim, so I don't really care what you think.
Well, at least I'm your personal enemy and not
personal
just,
enemy.
Not just
that's
some
right.
impersonal.
No,
enemy.
That's right. We'll be back with Jim to talk about way more than you'll probably want to hear. This is the First and People's Bank, Green Up Beacon Media Network.
At First and People's Bank and Trust, we're not only your home office, we're your hometown bank. We're your friends, your neighbors, even your relatives. When you enter our front door, you're going to be our number one priority, because here at First and People's Bank, we're here to serve you. Tired of dealing with that corporate bank where you're just a number? Come see us at First and People's Bank and Trust, where we'll treat you just like a friend. Whether you're buying your first house, your second house, or financing a new car, come see us at First and People's Bank and Trust.
Hello, everyone. My name is Christy Addington, and I'm with eXp Realty. We are an international real estate company that uses innovative and progressive techniques to help our buyers and sellers meet their real estate needs. I service Eastern Kentucky, Northeastern Kentucky, parts of West Virginia, and have connections all over the world. Please contact me at 606-547-1166. If you have any questions, I would love to help you. I can also be reached at my website, which is christyaddington.exprealty.com. Have a blessed day.
All drivers are not as careful as you are, and Kurt Robinson State Farm Insurance in Flatwoods reminds you to drive carefully at all times. For all your insurance needs, auto, home, life, and health, contact Kurt Robinson Insurance with over 28 years as a State Farm agent. Phone 836-3011. Auto quotes available 24/7 at 836-3011. Kurt Robinson Insurance, 1114 Belfont Road in Flatwoods.
Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
KEDC provides support and adds value to our members' districts through a united spirit of cooperation and innovation. With 67 member school districts statewide and over 50 years of service, KEDC is Kentucky's oldest and largest educational cooperative. KEDC is always interested in our young people by providing educational support services for its school members. Types of services provided: technical wiring, full collective bidding services, special education support, professional development opportunities for all school employees, adult education services, leadership development, and more. KEDC, your trusted partner in education. KEDC, 904 Rose Road, Ashland, Kentucky.
I've brought along with Jim Waters of the Bluegrass Institute. Jim and I have been friends since 98.
20 years.
20 years. Actually, it's 21.
Met you over in Breckenridge County.
Yes. I tried to hire you, and you wouldn't come.
Yeah, you did, actually.
I really wish you would have. We would have set the world on fire. There was so much stuff going on.
They had a great local restaurant over there, remember?
Irvin. it was in the Curve.
Yeah.
It was owned by two or three people, but... Yeah. the best bacon tomato sandwich
by
and
far.
Fries. Crinkle cut fries, double
love
cooked
the
in it.
Cut, yeah.
Oh my goodness.
You're making me hungry.
Look,
we're here,
look,
at, we're here at this great restaurant
let me
here.
Let me tell you, yeah, well, we'll
you're buying
day.
Lunch. You know?
Yes, I am. I'm sorry, Marilyn. I had to rob him to come up here. And then one other time, when I was running a paper in Lafayette, Tennessee, we met up down in Bowling Green and went to, I can't remember the name of that Japanese restaurant, but that was as fine a place as I've ever eaten.
Was. They had great service.
And they did. I mean, your drink never went empty, and you had all the diet tea you wanted. But I'll tell you what, let me tell you this. We never laughed harder in our life. It was a bocce, right? Yeah. There were people looking at us. I mean, it was like, who are these guys?
That's nothing new for me, though. That
well, no,
all the time,
but so. Me either. I'm tall and fat, you know. You're short and dumb, so we're all, you know, we kind of got it all together.
Thank you. I've had many other things said this week to
yes,
me that,
I know.
That pales in comparison.
I want people to know, I told you I was going to make an announcement. That Jim and I are friends, first. We don't agree about almost on anything politically.
I think deep down you agree more than you.
No, I think you agree. There are certain things, like when I ran on Mitch McConnell, Jim doesn't say anything. So that tells me all I needed to know. He doesn't defend him. So he'll go, mm-hmm.
I have been defending when I think his legacy will be the Supreme Court justices. That will be the court. And I think Senator McConnell has done more in that area to leave his legacy. And I think a lot of the other things will
fail. You know,
the funny
part is he's going to leave that legacy on both sides. That he blocked the President Obama's nomination. Yes, he did. Yeah. Don't start.
Yeah, no, but I think
it's my show.
No, just the answer. But you brought that up, so
yeah.
Show. So, but I was just gonna say, I think I think that does figure into it. But
yeah.
I think if you look at the total picture, and when you talk about legacy, you don't talk about one or two events. And I think that will be.
And I think that's what they're gonna remember. I agree with you.
Yeah, and you know, because the court outlives a president or outlives a majority leader. So, and I have to say, I think overall, he's probably done better work in that area overall. Now, I'm not saying, you know, but in the number of judges that have been confirmed, you know, there's been a serious problem with that over the years.
Right.
And he's worked with the other side to get that done. So I think I think on that, he's done real well.
You know? I like to pick at everything. You know that.
And people forget, Hank, when Senator McConnell first went to Washington, Kentucky was 4-1 Democrat.
Yeah.
So you don't win. And in Louisville, it was probably more like 6-7-1.
Right.
So you don't win without making deals.
Well,
you know?
Let me tell you, he's very good at that.
So.
You know the very first newspaper in the state of Kentucky to support him and write an endorsement for him was?
I wouldn't know because I wasn't here then. So.
It was the Georgetown News and Times, Hank Bond, publisher.
Very good.
He led the charge for the stolen and exploited children or kidnapped or whatever they were. He got them on the milk cartons. A lot of things people make fun of today were so critically important, Jim.
Yeah. Before we had phones and the communication.
And,
absolutely.
I mean, people get all upset because their phones throw these amber alerts out. But you know, Jim, we save one child.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's great what we've done with the technology, you know.
Yeah.
And for our cause at the Bluegrass Institute, I would say, and for groups like ours, the internet is the greatest tool that we've ever had to use.
Sure.
And if you believe in freedom, you don't have to agree on all the policy, but if you believe in freedom and liberty, there's no greater tool. Look at these countries where there have been entire movements that have been started on Facebook and totalitarian dictators overthrown and authoritarian leaders overthrown. And that's why, like when in Venezuela right now, they're cutting off all social media because they're trying to stop that.
I
predict they won't be able to
I don't think so either. Unless they tear down every cell tower and
They as a government are going to need some of that to even operate.
Yeah,
But I think it's really interesting. I'm not a I, you know even if I don't agree with politicians, like I think on some things I don't agree with Senator McConnell on, that's no big surprise. But I do think that you have to look, I think there's two ways of looking at it. You can disagree on particular policy issues, but then the overall legacy, that's a different view, I think, sometimes. Right. So,
in case no one knows, Jim is a Republican.
Well,
and I am not. He's going to tell you he votes for the man.
It's true. It really is. No, it is true.
Let me
clear that up now. Now, personally,
we'll be backing them up. No.
The Bluegrass Institute, of course, is nonpartisan.
Yeah.
So we don't support candidates.
No,
so I want to make that clear. We don't endorse candidates.
Correct.
What we do is endorse ideas, and I love that. We talk about ideas, not
And I try to do the same thing more than
you do.
Attacking someone. I mean, you know me 20 years. You read my paper sometimes. Mm-hmm. You know, yes, I have my opinions,
yeah.
And sometimes I have been a little staunch, but when I used to travel for work, Jim and I would spend hours on the phone screaming at each other. But at the end of the day, thank you, Barb and Charlie. If you have questions for Jim Waters, make sure you go over to the little thing on my Facebook page, and you can type in the question, and I'll ask Jim. But I want to talk about two completely different social media things that I really want to show how much I agree with you. We've had two incidences here. We had a young 29-year-old fireman. He was a member of the Dwarf Society. He was a little person, 29, passed away. The family engaged us to stream his funeral because he belongs to the same organization as the small gentleman on Game of Thrones, the little people. 8,300 people watched that young man's funeral because it got passed around. Secondly, and this has nothing to do with the Beacon, there's a young lady here who's a baby that's in the hospital who's the boyfriend, threw him against the wall, her against the wall. They put a thing on for GoFundMe and asked for $500. They're over 20 grand now. And that just shows you the caring of people. And not one time did somebody mention Obama or Trump or McConnell or Danny Bentley.
That's a great point. You know, Hank, the internet is not controlled by government. You know, it's not limited. And that's why we have to keep it that way. And I think it's important. Our journalists are agreeing on this, that
right. We
need to keep, even though you have a lot of people expressing views and radical groups, there are on there. But I think the community does a good job of bringing out.
Correct.
That's a much better way than government saying we're going to control or regulate this.
Right.
I think free speech is very important, and it's going to become even more important. You know, so I think our founders, even though they didn't have internet back then, they actually were very visionary.
Yeah, but they threw logs on for the smoke signals.
Yeah, they did.
And
that's the thing I would say about the founders. They had their faults, right? We know, and of course, slavery was becoming a big issue. And,
right.
But even with that, they made the way to fix that, even though they did fail in many areas with that. But I would say they made a way for us to have a society that would work and be diverse, but be free, and people would be free to follow their own desires and their own path. You know.
Well, and it gave everybody a mechanism to choose their own religious following and their own. And I do get a little irritated with some of the groups when they want to limit it to one religion or even one denomination. Sorry.
Limit what?
Well, in religion, they want to say only Christians or only Buddhists, or, you know, and
or only Muslims.
Or only Muslims.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, I know several Muslims in this tri-state, and I wouldn't know they were a Muslim if I didn't know.
Yeah.
You know,
I think the key there is
that
there's tolerance. Well, there has to be tolerance both ways.
Sure.
You know, I think in many, too many cases, but quite honestly, from my viewpoint, like over in Bowling Green, they're arguing about a fairness ordinance, you know? And there's a lot of vindictive things being said, and there's a lot of emotion, you know?
Oh, I know.
But here's what I would say is, you have to be tolerant. If you're going to, you know, you want people to be tolerant of your views and your rights and your freedoms, they also have to, it has to be a two-way street for it to work. So,
well, that's we jokingly say, that's why we always agree to disagree.
That's right.
It's not. That's right. And I don't know that we've ever personally, even kiddingly, attacked each other.
No, we never have.
Never have. I don't run his column only because I got accused of only running one-sided columns. And it isn't anything about Jimbo. It's not. I just have to take a look at... But if I don't run any political columns other than those that are office holders, the Senate and Robin Webb...
So I didn't know... I thought you were...
I do sometimes.
But... what I tried to avoid, like this last column was really, I got response from both sides because it's right. Policy.
Right.
It's not political. It's policy.
Well, policy is what it's about.
And that's what we're trying to do is like this whole issue with the pension system and the quasi agencies.
Yeah.
They're very concerned. To them, this is not a Republican or Democrat issue. We came this morning, we released a new plan for them, and I'm getting calls on my way here from quasi agencies saying we're very interested and we want the governor to get involved with this. So I think changing ideas, it's about ideas, it's about policy, you know.
We're going to take a break. We'll be back with Jim to talk a little bit more about a whole lot more. That's part of why I scheduled him late, was so that if we want to go an hour and a half, that we
I'm
can.
Here.
One thing before we take a break, Jim used to be in the newspaper business. Were you an editor?
I was an editor and a reporter and a columnist, a business column, business columns.
So,
You
know, he
and
understands.
And
a broadcaster.
Yeah.
He understands where we come from. He really does. He understands it. And again, I do not take a stand if I don't put my name on it. I don't do like the dailies and run an editorial and say it's a committee when it's not. It's one guy writing it and everybody else reading it. But if it's different than that, then they can show me. But I've worked at two giant dailies, and that's how it was. We'll be back with Jim to talk more in a couple minutes. First in People's Bank, Green at Beacon Media Network.
Chiropractic. You will enjoy state-of-the-art chiropractic facilities and discover the true wellness lifestyle. Dr. Terry Meredith is a member of Great Doctors of Chiropractic and has helped many in the Ashland area experience natural healing without surgery or drugs. If you're looking for a skilled chiropractic doctor, visit MeredithChiropractic.com, call 329-8158, or visit Dr. Meredith's office at 2120 Carter Avenue in Ashland. At Meredith Chiropractic.
Tri-State Enterprise is locally owned and operated, serving the Tri-State area. We pride ourselves on quality work, meeting the deadline, and customer satisfaction. All our staff are experts in their fields. Our division managers have over 110 years combined experience in construction, lawn care, electrical, and HVAC. Our staff has HVAC licensed technicians and installers. Our executives have over 45 years combined operations and service management experience, bringing multiple divisions together, making us one of the most diverse companies of the Tri-State area, from Flatwoods, Kentucky to Portsmouth, Ohio and Huntington, West Virginia. Tri-State Enterprise, 1305 Argolide Road, Flatwoods, Kentucky, 606-836-2534.
Recording their experiences, whether it's a selfie with a friend, a magnificent sunset, or their lunch, the power to pull out your phone and capture a moment in time is irresistible. When fans attend their favorite events like conventions, festivals, concerts, and sports, phones spring out to capture every special moment. Now imagine offering fans your exclusive up-close or action-packed content in a beautiful keepsake book. But not just any book. Our proprietary collaborative platform gives every fan the power to include their own photos with your content for something truly unique and personal that they'll treasure forever. And they can do it all from their phone. Hi, we're Fanbooks, and we work with partners like you to create and publish collaborative, on-demand keepsake books that your fans are gonna love. Fanbooks. We play for keeps.
for more than 100 years, the original mission of the firm hasn't changed. They've always intended to provide the best and most professional services complemented by the finest products. Carmen Funeral Home, people serving people since 1913, from pre-need to final arrangements. Carmen Funeral Home.
Are you an adult looking for a new career? A high school senior ready for a new and exciting journey? No matter your education goals, we have a path to get you there. We have lots of programs to help you get a high-paying job quickly or work toward a bachelor's degree. Take advantage of the state's lowest tuition, outstanding training programs for jobs in your area, and online classes. Enroll now. Ashland Community and Technical College. Higher education begins here.
Jim Waters with the Bluegrass Institute, my longtime friend. I mean, anybody will drive up to Bowling Green. I only had to bribe him with a lunch. It's pretty good.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
But
yeah.
You know, I've had Julian Tackett. I did go to Lexington, but only because he was between tournament seasons and it was impossible for him. I've invited Cliff Shoemate from Paris, who's used to be those Expandex pants that used to be Bluegrass Industries, his dad, and he's in the Blackberry business now and writes books. And I think he's still in the clothing business. Sloppy Joe's was the name of the clothing item. He might be on your side of the pallet there. We have a guest with us today who is very knowledgeable about the issues of the Commonwealth. And for a guy that can't read, it just really impresses me the amount of knowledge that he has. And where'd you go to school, Jim?
Well, are you talking about
college? Well, let's start out with high school.
Okay, so I graduated from Wabash High School, president of my class, 1982, in Wabash, Indiana.
Just a baby.
A small blue market town, or blue-collar town.
Right.
And they really got hit hard with the downturn in the economy, about a decade ago. But they're rebounding, and they're getting some new economy-type businesses, so they're having to reinvent themselves. But I graduated from there actually went into the ministry for a while.
Right.
And went to, actually, my degree is from Summit Theological Seminary, which is up in Indiana. But I feel like I've gotten a PhD working with a lot of people I've had a chance to work.
Yeah.
Well, they say, the school of hard knocks, the school colors are black and blue, a lot of the people I work with in this work of public policy, I really have gotten a true education about what's going on here and how to solve some of these issues, and not only from what's happening here, but what's happening around the country, And I had a chance a year and a half ago to introduce the governor out at the Heritage Foundation National Resource Bank meeting. That's right. I have had some national platforms in the last few years to speak about, particularly about how we move the ball down the field. How do you get policy changed? An idea is great, but unless you have a strategy. And one of the things I've learned, Hank, is patience. When you're dealing with public policy, a lot of people come into this, and it's not like politics. It's not the same. In politics, you have a campaign, you take a vote on November 4th or whatever, and it's over, right? But with public policy, for example, 2 years ago, we did get a charter school bill passed. But there was no funding apparatus with it. So see, it's an ongoing policy issue. So what I like to say is we take a bite out of the apple. How do you get to the core of the thing? You take bites, right? And so I've learned, and the people that I've had a chance to, I think, influence and who've come to the Institute to work with us have really learned this. And it's a great thing. Yeah, if you're going to change policy, it's not going to happen as fast as a political campaign, but when it does happen, it's going to be big. And I saw the Brady industry. I always see the sign when I get off the interstate coming out here, and after you get off, and I think about some of the changes in our policy that attracted them here. Now, what's going to happen there is still working out. But a lot of companies have told us that they've decided to come to Kentucky because of changes in our policy, which is much more important in the long run than changes in which political party is the governor or controls the House. You know,
one of the things I found, I was a publisher of the Georgetown Papers, I said earlier, when Toyota came, you know, they wanted to lynch Martha Lane and given $393 million tax breaks. I think it was a good deal she made.
Well, on the issue of incentives,
I'll stand on that.
Yeah,
statement.
Well, Toyota, and I think, I'm not saying it never works. I think it does, you know, and certainly the return on Toyota.
You have to know what you're doing. Sure.
Now, one of the things I find interesting about Toyota is that the labor unions have tried to organize there, and the people say, we already have a good relationship with management. You know, we're getting paid in the industry. They're at the top of their industry, and so and then we had this new announcement here in the last recent months. Which, I don't
another,
think...
Another 1,500 jobs?
Yeah, another $1.5 billion was going to turn out.
Right.
But the point I want to make about that is we had the Amazon announcement up in northern Kentucky, which Ohio was in the running for that, but Ohio hasn't done some things that we've done here now in terms of right to work, in terms of prevailing wage issues, all these other issues, not just those other issues. And so we see the Amazon announcement, we see the Toyota announcement, we have the Brady announcement. So my point is that policy has consequences. Changes in policy have consequences, and they usually outlast political changes.
Right.
So, for example, in the next election, it basically doesn't matter who wins that election. We're going to be a right-to-work state. It's not going to be undone. Okay, and once you get a policy like that, so that's what I like about what I do and what we do and what I think is important. On the incentives issue, we've made the case, you know, that if we create such a vibrant economy here where people are attracted to come here, then and a lot of these companies tell us, Hank, they say, yeah, the incentives do play a role, but it's not the most important thing. It's not the most important reason why we come. If we get incentives and we don't have a workforce, then, you know, it doesn't matter how big the incentive checks are, you know. And there was a gun manufacturer, what's the name of it, that was going to come to Kentucky, was looking at Kentucky. It's a 500-year-old company. I can't remember the name of it.
Is it Remington or Winchester?
No, it's... It's on the tip of my tongue. Anyhow, it's on. I wrote columns about it. But they were going to come to the Bardstown area, central Kentucky. Well, at that time, this was the previous administration. Well, they offered them a ton of incentives. And they even offered, the local governments offered them a ton of property tax incentives, and every kind of incentive. The state even threw in $1 million extra for infrastructure improvements.
Right.
But that company ended up going to Gallatin, Tennessee, about 30 miles south of our border.
I know where it is.
So what I'm saying is they offered them tremendous incentives, you know. But that's not the only thing that matters to companies. And I think that's where a lot of the attention gets laid. My other problem with that is if you have a company that's been a good, loyal citizen in a community for 25 years. We saw this with a shoe company a few years ago. And, you know, they've hired people from the community. They've contributed. They've been good citizens, community citizens. A lot of people have sent their kids to college with those jobs, and they've never really ever gotten any incentives from government. And then you have another company that government brings in because of the incentives or offers them huge incentives, and they may stay till the incentives, as long as the incentives are there, and then we've seen where companies have taken off. But how fair is that to the company that's been there, you know, competing, or to make them compete against a company that has an unfair advantage? And that's what that is. So we really have to think about all of those things, I think. You know,
that's why we don't sell our paper. That way I'm not, I noticed that all papers that are paid papers will discount for new subscribers. But they won't send the umbrellas to the people that have subscribed for 39 years.
That's a good point. That's a great. And so if you have a local company, you know, and then all of a sudden they're forced to compete against a new company that has the advantage of a government, government essentially a subsidy. And I'm not going to say it never works.
Toyota worked.
But on the other hand, I would just raise the specter, okay, that we don't know for sure. I don't think anybody can say, maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong, but we don't know that it wouldn't have worked necessarily without the incentives, okay? We don't know that.
I was there.
Yeah.
I know what was said in the judge's office before they proceeded on to the governor.
Yeah.
But I agree with you.
And I'm not talking about whether they would have come or not.
Right.
I'm not talking about that.
How it would have worked
out. I'm talking about would they have been successful?
One thing Toyota did, just like the Bradys have done here, Toyota bought Cardone and gave it to the city for the old monastery, it's where the nuns were, mm-hmm. and they gave them that entire building, the town could use it for things, They were very, and still are.
Now, I have a serious problem, though, with this direct taxpayer dollars into a company. Now, when you're talking about incentives, the incentives with Toyota, for example, or these other companies, are based on the performance of the company.
They were tax incentives.
Yeah, they were
not upfront money.
Yeah, right. So I don't have it. That's less of a problem than upfront direct. See, if you start putting taxpayer dollars directly into a company, then you have all of the issues involved about transparency, open records, open meetings, and the taxpayers are all of a sudden directly on the hook and at risk. Now, I'm not saying it won't work, as far as in terms of success, but I think the better approach on that is that there needs to be some return on that investment. There needs to be a proving or evidence that these incentives actually did create more jobs, actually did help, but I think it's a much better approach. What a much better approach is, and this is a little bit out in front of that, is if we could become such an economically attractive state,
true,
that we would attract all kinds of companies, and it wouldn't be government deciding which companies they wanted to give incentives to. Rather, it would be people knocking on our doors, and small companies, mid-sized, large, saying, we want to come here. I think that's what we at least should be striving for, And I get pushback on this. People say, well, all the other states do this, and we have to compete.
If your brother jumped off a bridge with you, that's used to be what I tell my kids. Yeah. But now, you didn't really experience this end of the state in the 60s. Because you probably were barely born, but this place used to be an unbelievably economic mushroom here. You had thousands of jobs at the CSX, which was CNO in those days.
The railroad.
Chesapeake and Ohio, now it's CSX. Thousands of jobs at the yards, thousands of jobs at the roundhouse where they did all this. They even had to build the YMCA here, the railroad YMCA, where the engineers would sleep. The reason it failed was the union demanded that each room have a restroom. Well, of course, when they built it, it was sort of like a school. It was gang showers and bathrooms, and the contract stopped that, so thus they stopped. It took a few years for it to stop, but it did. But then you had Armco Steel. I think somebody told me it was 9,800 employees at one time, and now it's shut. By the end of this year, the last 200 will be gone. Ashland Oil's world headquarters set here. When they became Marathon, and now there's still some Ashland Oil things, but Marathon is the takeover, thousands of people. We have the refinery here. We still have some jobs here.
You know what else you have here? You have a workforce.
Well, that's what I was going to say. It's where I was going.
Yeah.
Brady, all they got to do is open the door. The college has already put the previous president, the current president, they've streamlined and developed classes to prepare people to be just exactly what they need. Not just what they need, but exactly what they need.
And I have to tell you, other than
this $15 million, which is not a large amount in the overall scheme of things. I mean, a lot of legislators didn't know what they were voting for when they did that. But other than that, and it may not be perfect in that area, but I think this is a tremendous project. This is, and you have to look at this and say, especially for the timing of this in this area, and how relevant this is. You have people, and you know, out here, you have people that want to work. You know, they're not people sitting around waiting to get a check, wait on a check from the government every month. They want to work, and they not only have a work ethic, many of them do have some of the skills, and they need some more training maybe in some areas. But what a great, you know, you don't have to attract people to come out here. You've got the people. And that's what I think is one of the greatest things about this. Also, I think that this also speaks to the low cost of energy in our state. You know, aluminum manufacturers want two things, basically. They need to be close to water, you know, but they also need an abundant supply of energy that is relatively inexpensive. And Kentucky produces 40% of America's aluminum. Right. There's a reason for that, because we have an abundant supply of energy. And unless we make use of that, unless we keep those prices down and those rates down, these companies won't go to other states. They're going to go to China, and they're going to go to Mexico, and they're going to go elsewhere. And so I think it's hugely important that we, you know, with this, it's an aluminum sheet metal, right, if I got that right, what they're going to produce, and they're going to attract more business as they get going, as they get started. But it's aluminum. It's amazing. And aluminum in this state, it's really one of the great untold manufacturing stories, I think. There's all kinds of opportunity there, too. You know, I think this is going to have a collateral impact in this area. It's not just going to be Brady. It's going to be other industries.
Just on the main, just like when Toyota came, everybody thought in 30 days it was going to be. That's not how it works.
Right.
You get your plant up, bring in all those construction workers, you have new restaurants pop up, you have a hotel or two built. You know, you improve the airport down here, the Ashland, what used to be called Ashland Oil Airport, so that small jets can land, and I think they can now. But my point is, it's such a sweeping tsunami,
right?
And people don't get that.
It doesn't happen in a vacuum. You know, when I was here the last time after our program, I talked to people intentionally about Brady and about Armco and the steel and sort of the Marathon. I actually met some of the people from Ashland or Marathon at a reception in Lexington. I was talking with them about this too, you know, and people were genuinely excited about this. You know, they were excited about too, Hank, is they don't want to leave here. They don't want to have to go somewhere else to find work to support their families. They want to be here, and this is part of the tradition of this area. And I've learned a lot about this from people who's come from generations of families here, you know?
Right.
And there are people who even leave here, and I don't want to sound morbid, I think this is really kind of neat. They come home to die. They want to be buried here. They want to be buried with their generations of families. And I think people outside of the area may not understand that completely, right, all the time.
Yeah,
and it's hugely important, but for what you're doing here, and they understand it. And I talk, and the people here, not only the people I talk to, but the people that are doing these companies, they understand how important that is, the cultural connection that people have with this area. I think it's neat. I do.
We'll take another break and be back to talk about the reason Larry made the trip up here. This is the first...
Wrong name.
What did I call you, Larry?
Yeah, Larry and Larry. Larry and Larry.
Larry and Larry. That was a guy before you. Jim Waters from the Bluegrass Institute. I'll take the blame for that.
It's okay.
It's only because I can't remember anything anymore. This is the First and People's Bank, Green at Beacon Media Network.
Pappy's Cooking has breakfast all day. Hand-pattied burgers and an all-you-can-eat soup and salad bar. Our friendly staff is here to make sure you have a great dining experience, because we want our patrons to be treated like family. Pappy's Cooking, 2135 Argolite Road, Suite L, Flatwoods. Call 606-836-9000. 3663. New name, new address. Sharp Accounting and Insurance, now at 1200 Diedrich Boulevard, Russell, Kentucky, in the former AAA building. Call Philip Sharp today for your auto, home, business insurance needs at 606-324-0696 or Sharp Accounting at 606-324-5655 for your IRS taxes, accounting, and payroll services.
At First and People's Bank and Trust, we're not only your home office, we're your hometown bank. We're your friends, your neighbors, even your relatives. When you enter our front door, you're going to be our number one priority, because here at First and People's Bank, we're here to serve you. Tired of dealing with that corporate bank where you're just a number? Come see us at First and People's Bank and Trust, where we'll treat you just like a friend. Whether you're buying your first house, your second house, or financing a new car, come see us at First and People's Bank and Trust.
Jim Waters with the Bluegrass Institute on the Green at Beacon Video News Magazine. And
by the way, people can read my column if they want to read it online, past columns at bibs.org, our website.
B-I-B-B-S.
And then we have a new website called KentuckyPensionTruth.com. Spell out Kentucky. KentuckyPensionTruth.com. And it has national, state, and local pension news. And then it has our research and our work on there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So.
Yeah, he's always going to run something at me. Brought to you by Jim Waters.
No, I just wanted to throw that in.
No, Jim does a lot of things. He always has. He didn't start out as president of the Institute, but he's since taken on that responsibility. And you know, you're like me, you sleep 2 hours, sometimes an hour and a half at a time.
Sleep? What's that?
Yes, right. I know one night when I was in the hospital and I was trying to figure out whether he was going to come up and we were going to do it in the hospital room or not. And something big happened and you really didn't want to come that day. And we went ahead and canceled it. But at the end of the day, when you can call somebody up at 2 o'clock and says, Hank, what do you want? You know that he sleeps less than you do.
It was actually 1 o'clock in the Central
Time.
True.
So, yeah.
I will say, I would like to mention that we've added a couple of great people to our team. And particularly Sarah Durand, who worked in the Bevin with Governor Bevin on his campaign. She was communications director, and she was also the former chief of staff for our First Lady, Glenna Bevin, and she's joined us. She has a tremendous background and political background, and she's very talented. We're very excited about having her as our government relations person. So if you're up in Frankfort and you legislators and policymakers and stakeholders, you'll probably run into Sarah if you're up there any length of time. So we're excited about having her on our team. And Dr. Bill Smith, who has headed up our pension effort, Dr. Smith was actually nominated by Governor Bevin to be on the Kentucky Retirement Systems Board. But Dr. Smith, we're fortunate that he decided to come and work with us. And just today, we've released a new idea about quasi-governmental agencies, about what we can do.
Yeah, I saw.
So take a look at that.
Some of the conversation.
And I'm getting good response from across the political spectrum, which is what we want.
So, right. Yeah. Well,
you don't solve problems if you just talk to your, talk to yourself or your choir.
Or your friends.
Yeah.
Right.
That's right.
It really doesn't.
Yeah. So thanks for the plug.
Well,
I did good on that, didn't I?
I will tell you, Jim, that I'm proud of what you've done. I am, and I think you're an accomplished guy. He likes the kvachka grill. I've never seen him meet a piece of food he didn't like.
I like a lot of things.
Yeah, well, I know you do. As long as the service is good.
Exactly. That's service right. is important.
It is.
It's hard to find good
Every
service.
Every time, it is.
But I found the hibachi restaurants have usually generally very good service.
They do. So. And if they don't, you just say, I want somebody else.
That's right.
And I've done that.
Yep.
I have too.
No, I tell you, Hank, what I wanted to do with my life is do something that matters, that makes a difference. I don't expect, my goal here is not to get everybody to agree on every issue.
No, it's to discuss it.
It's to debate it. So many times, especially local governments, are really bad about, they don't debate these issues like a lot. Now, some, I think we're getting better about this, but we, transparent government is not just knowing who voted how. Transparent government is knowing how the, how that we arrived at that point.
Right.
What the discussion was. You know, that's why the Bluegrass Institute sued the House of Representatives, you know, last, you know, year and a half ago, because they had a closed door meeting about the public pension system, called it a caucus meeting, and invited the other caucus. Well, the whole legislature was there.
That's a quorum. And that's the closed meeting.
That's right. And the most liberal member of that group, the whole group, is Representative Jim Wayne out of Louisville, who stood up and said, I demand the doors to this meeting be open or I'm leaving. You know, so we work with people across the board. He was supportive of what we were doing. And we won that case, by the way. The courts agreed with us and said that was a violation of the Open Meetings Act. Now, did we do it because we don't like the people in the House? No, it wasn't about that.
You were representing the people, right, of Kentucky.
And I don't want them doing that again. I want them to know that if they do that, it's going to be a painful experience, right?
Right.
You know, as far as politically goes.
In the era we live, charter schools have become a giant discussion point. Jim, their policies at this time lean in the direction of the belief that charter schools are a good thing. And I'm going to allow Jim now to talk. And I'll try not to interrupt you other than to make fun of you once in a while to keep you on track. But I would like you to talk about Commissioner DeVos, her thoughts. I'm not totally impressed with her, partly because her stake in education is not near like yours. You had children in school and right here, and she didn't. She homeschooled and did those type of things. I'm not saying she's a bad person.
Well, we're homeschooling parents too. So,
are you?
Yeah. But we do a hybrid. Our youngest did a hybrid program this year with the public online. So the point about school choice is and that's a good place to start, I think, is,
let me turn the camera.
Is a I think, Hank, if we can recognize, first of all, that our position on school choice, giving parents a choice of where they send their children to school, does not mean that we believe all public schools are failures or that public schools don't have a big role to play, because they do. Our view, our issue is that not all children benefit from the same kind of education. We need to have options for parents, and this has been proven. The first charter school in America was in 1992, so this was up in Minnesota, the first charter school. So it's not a new idea. It's 25, 26 years old.
It is funny that I read about that today.
Okay. So it's 20. So my point being, when it first started, skeptics could say, rightfully, you know, you don't know how this is going to work. You don't know what the results of this are going to be and if it's going to really work. But now we've had a quarter of a century to look at the results.
Right.
And what we found is that, especially in urban areas, and let's start with that, because I also want to talk about where we are here, we're through, but starting with urban areas, charter schools have provided the answer for a lot of low-income, poor, minority kids who were already headed for dropout status. They were falling through the cracks. So you have kids that aren't making it in a traditional public school system. Our research indicates that our public education system is doing a fantastic job, and I mean, I'm talking about a great job with about 25% of the students. And that mean, what I mean by that is those students can compete against the kids from India, from China, from North, or from South Korea, all these areas. And so that's what I'm talking about. Now, we're also having about the same percentage drop out of those schools.
Right.
And that leaves a big middle where a lot of kids are getting, maybe in some cases, a decent, maybe a mediocre education, but they're not getting everything they need. So what we want to see happen is we want to see parents of children who the traditional public education system does not work for them for whatever reason, and it can be a ton of reasons, that they have options that will mean that that child won't drop out, that child won't lose out, that they will get the education that they need. And we're seeing from a ton of research, increased amount of research, that charter schools in inner city areas are reaching particularly the low-income minority kids, more low-income and tend to be minority, although that's not the major. The major issue is the low-income kids who come from often generations of families who have not even graduated from high school, who have not learned how to read, who have not learned how to do these basic things. And in our economy today, we have in the Bowling Green area, in a 10-county area around South Central Kentucky, there are 50,000 job openings right now. I saw the breakdown. These are not just service jobs. These are manufacturing jobs. These are high-tech jobs. These are jobs, though, that require a basic education, okay? And so, and I brought some information on this, but let me just also speak to the whole thing about charter schools failing. And there's kind of a cottage industry that has sprung up that simply focuses on the failure of charter schools. And let me say, there have been charter schools that have failed. You know, we've started in this country over 7,000 charter schools. About 700 of those have failed. So about 10% of those schools. They fail for various reasons. Financial mismanagement. They failed because they failed to meet the expectations of parents. And remember, a charter school, no one's forced to go to a charter school. A charter school is chosen by the parent or by the guardian. So no one's forced to go. It's a school choice. And so they have a charter which says, in exchange for more freedom from some of the regulations that traditional public schools have, we will perform at a higher level. We will meet this expectation of academic performance and of training kids in social skills, preparing them for life, preparing them for either college or career, whatever their preparation is. And so if they don't meet those expectations, we believe that those schools should not continue to fail students. All right? Now, in the traditional public school system, if a school is failing students, oftentimes what we see is more money put into that school, a change of maybe the leadership, a change of some of the staff, rearranging things in the school, maybe changing the name of the school, or maybe changing the designation. Like at one time in Kentucky, we had persistently low achieving schools. You know, now it's priority schools, or now it's a different name. But the problem is you can't continue to fail students who aren't making it for whatever reason. And I'm not saying it's because of any one reason. It could just not be the right environment for them. We know kids that are doing online charter schools that were not making it in the traditional school, and they're getting their degrees, and they're getting good jobs, and they're making it, and they're being successful. We want bad schools to close, whether they're charter schools or traditional public schools. We want that to happen. We've had 3 or 4 superintendents in Kentucky that have been in prison or have been in trouble because they committed financial mismanagement in their districts. This is not a problem that is just for charter schools. This has been a problem across the board. So I think it's unfair to judge charter schools based on the fact that some of them have failed. As a matter of fact, if they've closed, I'm saying that's an accountability factor that says if these schools don't make it, we've got a mechanism whereby we can shut them down and they're not going to be allowed to continue to fail students. And then we found that most students who come to a charter school are already behind because they weren't succeeding in wherever they were at before. So they tend to be 2 to 3 grades behind. And the Stanford University has a Center for Education Research there, and there's a group called Credo. They research charter schools, everything about charter schools. And Caroline Hawksby, who is a premier researcher, African-American, by the way, and one of the best-known researchers in the country on this, has found that the longer kids are in a charter school, the more they begin to outperform in inner city areas, and particularly the kids in the traditional public schools. And now, if you go to our website, you can find this. But like in Cleveland, for example, one of the favorite punching bags of charter school opponents are some of the problems that charter schools had in Ohio. And they did have some serious problems up there. But they have turned this around to the point where the charter schools in Cleveland, for example, I'm looking here at the NAEP scores. This is the National Assessment of Educational Progress. And when you break it down by race, and that's very important to do, is to break down the numbers by racial components in that. What we're finding, for example, in 2017, the latest numbers we have, are in grade four math, fourth grade math, charter students were scoring a 224 versus a 207 for non-charter student scores. Those are the scores of black students, I should say, in charter schools in Cleveland versus the traditional public schools. There's a 17 point difference in that. That's almost a 10% gap between the performance of black students in charter schools and black students in the traditional public schools. We're not talking about apples to oranges here. We're not talking about black kids versus rich white kids or any of that. We're talking about apples to apples. And we have found it's extremely important to make those comparisons. But look at this. I would just say Cleveland, Atlanta, Arizona, New York, Washington. We've looked at all those and continue to look. And in every key area, fourth grade math and reading, eighth grade math and reading, which the NAEP test in both of those grades, in every one of those categories, every one of them, in every city, the black students in the charter schools are outperforming the black students in the traditional public schools. So if you care about whether our kids are graduating prepared for the marketplace, prepared to compete, and if you care about kids that are being left behind for whatever reason, they're falling behind, we can say falling behind, left behind, I think you have to say there's some really great opportunities here for parents who might not have any other choices to get an education for their children. Now, when it comes to rural areas, we're finding some interesting things going on around the country in terms of online charter schools. In many rural areas, the school districts cannot afford to have advanced placement classes, for example, for kids, but they need to have those opportunities, you know, so they can go to the classroom for the classes that are provided. They can move on for kids who want to excel and maybe do some dual college and maybe prepare themselves or maybe want higher level math classes. A lot of times we're finding the rural districts can't always provide that for students. So why not use the technology like we were talking about before? And in Pennsylvania, they're doing something. I just was reading about this. They're doing interactive charter schools where students may be sitting at home at their desk, but they have a button. Instead of raising their hand, they have a button they can push, and the teacher responds to them right there on the screen in real time. So they're asking their questions, and they're getting help right there like they would in a classroom. So my point is we need to be more innovative. And I'm not stuck on one thing. I mean, for example, scholarship tax credits. Now, Secretary DeVos, I was with her a couple of weeks ago in Lexington and with the governor, and Trump administration is actually doing something very good in this area. And they want to provide a tax credit for providing scholarships for low-income children. And so they want to provide this on a federal, against your federal tax liability, but they want the states to decide how it would be work best in their state. So in Kentucky, it's conceivable that people could make, if we get our scholarship tax credit bill passed here, which I think it's going to happen in the next session, it's conceivable that people could make contributions. Take a Brady Industries, let's say, once they get up and running, as a business, they could make a contribution to a 501c3 scholarship tuition organization, and they could apply that against their state tax liability up to a certain point. But the great thing about that is the money then would get into the hands of kids to go to a private school. I know there are churches out here who would start Christian schools, have strong Christian education. And it's not for everybody. That's not for everybody. Charter schools aren't for every student. Those schools wouldn't be for every student. Public schools aren't for every student. The point is, we need as many options as possible. And I tell you something, we're falling behind other states in this. Indiana has 10 different school choice programs, 10 different ones. I mean, they have a thriving charter school program. They have a private, they even have a voucher program. They have a scholarship tax credit program. They have lots of ideas. So what I liked about Secretary DeVos's presentation was that it wasn't about the federal government coming and saying, we're going to have this program and this is how you're going to do it. What they want to do is they're putting the idea out there, and they called us to come and talk about how that would work best in Kentucky. And I think that's a great way to do this. You know, I think there's some great ideas. We have too many kids in Kentucky that just are not making it in the traditional public education system. They're dropping out of school. I know the Beshear administration, they passed the law, that they got the law passed about forcing kids to stay in school. But you know, we go to these charter schools all around the country, and the kids want to be there. The kids want to learn. We're talking about inner city kids. We're talking about rural areas where they've turned their entire district into charter school district. So the parents can say, maybe here, how many elementary, you have a couple elementary schools in the county here.
Several.
Yeah. So in that case, what parents could say is, maybe I want my child to go to this school, you know, instead.
And eight or nine.
See, they would have. So what that does, the residual impact, the collateral impact of that, if you will, is it causes everybody to improve their game. And this is the research has shown. Whenever at least 6% of a school's students, a traditional public school students, leave and go to a charter school, the school they left improves.
Right.
And so all of a sudden we have a program, a policy that maybe, if 10% of the kids took advantage, it'd be a high number. But what we do have is also improvement occurring in the place where there are the most kids. And I think this is really important, that we have improvement in our public education system. I think innovation and improvement. Innovation. You know, we've got all this technology. We've got all of this. We need to have, when Brady comes in here, what a great opportunity for apprenticeship programs for students here to get some real life experience. High school kids, you know, to get started on their career. And what we found in charter schools, another exciting thing is, they can emphasize things. So every school has its own board and its own charter. So we know charter schools around the country that are science and math meccas. I mean, that's what they emphasize. That's what parents want those kids to have. Other schools have an emphasis on the arts or on music or drama or whatever it is. And see, kids come there and they're getting their education. They're getting the education that works best for them. I was reading about online charter schools. We actually have one in Kentucky. It's called the Barron Area Virtual and Expanded Learning Center. The Barron Virtual and Expanded Learning Center, BAVL. And the Barron Academy, sorry, Barron Academy of Virtual and Expanded Learning. If you go on our website, type in BAVL, B-A-V-E-L, you can see great work on this. But a few years ago, the valedictorian of the graduating class from BAVL, she had gone there because she wanted to have a music career, and she was already getting started on that, and she had to be in Nashville a lot. But she graduated as the valedictorian because she was able to do her classes at the times that she could do them. Another young man who was the salutatorian he wanted to work. He had gotten a job. He loved working. And he told his parents, if I have to go back and sit in a classroom, I'm not going to do it. But when he got involved with BAVL, he graduated the number two person in his class. It wasn't because he was dumb that he wanted, he was actually had a plan in mind for his own life. You know, and I think we just have to start allowing parents to have more choices. Are there some bad eggs out there? Yes. Are there some bad charter schools? Absolutely. And that's why we have emphasized at the Bluegrass Institute that we want the law to hold these schools accountable. On the other hand, we want them to be free, to be innovative, to do the things that make charter schools work in other areas around the country. Hugely important. Huge important. So what I'm excited about is these schools, maybe in some areas you might have one great charter school, or you might have 10, you know, or you might have, you know, or here, I think for this area, I think maybe applying those concepts of where you let parents have a choice. Why not? Why not? They live here. And if a school works better for their child, and you know what we found? There's actually schools work better for one sibling and it doesn't work for the other one. So they find a different school. Why not allow parents to have that opportunity? I think it's really important. And I'm not stuck on one model. I think there's a lot of good opportunities out there. You know, you have a strong church community out here, a strong Christian community. there's a lot of opportunity here for that, you know, where they, and you know, as a parent, and I'm still, I've got two teenage girls at home. I mean, I'm concerned about the future generation of parents being able to have more options than I had, you know, and I want to do what I can. So we've heard, you know, I have to tell you this. There's a program in Louisville, Hank, called School Choice Scholarships. It's a private program. They raise the money privately. It's a nonprofit, but they raise the money privately to do what we want to do through the scholarship tax credits. They do the same thing. The people give their money voluntarily to this program, and they're able to help about 400 students. This is amazing. And to get a scholarship, you have to be the poorest of the poor. You have to actually be at the poverty level, because they have, here's why, they have 6,000 kids on the waiting list. 6,000. And these kids are getting these scholarships. They're going to Catholic schools, they're going to private schools, they're going to other, these are poor kids. They would never have this opportunity. And now, after 20 years in this program, we've told some of the stories. We told the story of two sisters over in Rwanda, who their grandmother carried them out of Rwanda during the war. And their parents, they lost their parents. They were orphaned. She walked them out of the country, across the country, into the Congo. Their names are Sylvie and Pacifique Umahosa. And now both of them are living the American dream. They got a scholarship from School Choice Scholarships in Louisville. They ended up in America. They're living the American dream. We've got 6,000 kids in Jefferson and Oldham counties alone. That's just those areas that want this opportunity. And so why not give parents that opportunity, you know?
So we're going to take our final break. I've got a couple more points for Jim. And I see that Jim Cantor, he was watching. I don't know if he's still watching or not. But Jim, if you want to pose a question, go ahead and type it on there. And I'll be glad to ask Jim or anyone else who would be interested in asking a question. I can only get Jim, can really only come up once a year because the tires on his car are kind of worn and Mama won't let him out of Warren County down there. But
I'm in Lexington, but it's still 100 miles.
Are you living in Lexington?
No, I'm not living here.
Oh, you have to
work. I'm in there a lot, yes.
Yeah.
So just let me know, Hank.
Right.
Well, hey, I love coming out, seriously.
I do, and I'm glad you come because you offer a totally unique perspective, and for that I appreciate it.
Thank you.
We'll take a break and be back. This is the First of People's Bank, Greta Beacon Media Network.
Welcome to Bellefonte Animal Clinic. Dr. Amy Bess is a licensed veterinarian treating dogs, cats, and other small animals. Your pet's health and well-being are very important, and Dr. Bess and staff will take every step to give your pet the best possible care. Bellefonte Animal Clinic is a full-service animal clinic and will take routine wellness cases as well as medical, surgical, and dental issues. Dr. Amy Bess, Bellefonte Animal Clinic, 1500 Kenwood Drive, Russell. Call 606-836-9933.
Is a full-service agency associated with Nationwide Insurance, one of the largest insurance companies in the United States. Nationwide's financial strength remains strong. To reach Brent Roark at 721 Bellefonte Road in Flatwoods, phone 836-6666.
Nationwide is on your side.
At First and People's Bank and Trust, we're not only your home office, we're your hometown bank. We're your friends, your neighbors, even your relatives. When you enter our front door, you're going to be our number one priority, because here at First and People's Bank, we're here to serve you. Tired of dealing with that corporate bank where you're just a number? Come see us at First and People's Bank and Trust, where we'll treat you just like a friend. Whether you're buying your first house, your second house, or financing a new car, come see us at First and People's Bank and Trust.
And we're back for our final segment here on the Greta Beacon Video News Magazine. I like to repeat twice that it's the longest running online magazine in the tri-state. We've had over 7 years of production and thousands, more than thousands of viewers. I counted one year, we had 72,000 in one year. So,
well, you're providing, Hank, here. I mean, local news is, people really need to have this access.
Well, and we're down
and
to
you're
the
providing
point.
This, yeah.
All right, you have a point to make, and I have a point to make. So you go ahead and make your point.
So were there any questions about
that? I haven't gotten any on here. So
I'm happy, though. If people do have a question, follow-up question, they can email me at jwaters@freedomkentucky.com. Spell out Kentucky. jwaters@freedomkentucky.com. I'm happy to... Or they can give me a call at the Institute. I'm happy to talk to them. I did want to say a word about some work we're doing with site-based decision-making
right.
councils, school-based decision-making councils, or SBDMs, as most people know. And this session, we think the legislature did take a good bite out of the apple by allowing superintendents in Jefferson and Fayette counties, I believe, to actually make the decisions regarding which principals, you know, would serve. We think this is important because if you're going to hold people accountable for how people perform, then they have to have the authority, I think, to hire and also to direct their work. But we're pushing for some more reforms on this in the future. We think that asking teachers really to do a site-based council right and to be on a council and really fulfill it, it takes a great amount of time. It takes people with expertise in personnel, human resources, in financial issues. And so we really think that some of that needs to be returned. For example, financial matters need to really be returned to the school board of that area, of the area. Now, and personnel decisions need to be really largely in the hands of the principal of the school. However, we think that
they really are, though, Jim.
Well, no, they are in some cases.
The truth of
what we need to do is put it. We need to make sure it's in policy, though.
But the truth of the matter is, if you read the rules, the principal can. All they have to do is advise the site base.
Yeah.
I'm hiring Jim Waters.
Yeah. And there's been some progress, but what we want to see. We want to make sure that,
yeah,
particularly on, I think financial issues is where we, that
well,
and
I,
personnel,
I,
yeah, we're
I think that, that so. You should give the school the budget and that school and principal should be allowed to handle it.
We don't have any problems with that, with advising, but here's what we want, really. We want some kind of appeals process for a parent. So let's say a parent comes to a site-based council and the school's not doing well and they want changes made. And the site-based council, right now, the way the makeup is, you know, they have the majority say on the council.
Sure.
So we just want, I think what would really be a great, right, we want them to be able to go to the school board, Hank. And we elect a school board. The school board is elected by the people to oversee the district. So
set the budget and hire the superintendent.
Yeah,
that's all.
Yeah, but if the decisions about finances or about curriculum issues or about personnel are not in the best interest of that school for whatever reason or for those students, the parents need some way to, they need to be able to come to the school board. So
most districts here have a curriculum, I don't know if you call them assistant superintendent, but they're board office bound, and that's all they do is work with the
But at the end of the day, according to the law right now, the site-based council can override some things that we're concerned about. So we want to make sure in these three areas, curriculum, personnel, and finances. I was greatly disturbed to find out in my research of CARA, when CARA was passed, that, and you might be able to add some, enlighten me on this a little more. But
because I'm older than
that's,
he is.
I was going to say that, but no. But there was actually discussion about getting rid of elected school boards. And I think that's the wrong direction. But if we're going to have elected school boards, what is going to be their role? Now, we can say hire the superintendent and set the budget, okay? But if they're going to be like promoting tax increases, for example, they need to be able to have also some say in how that those dollars are being spent. But right now, basically, I think and you're right in terms of what our really key concern is that you have some districts where not all schools are doing well with this.
Correct.
And then you have some that are doing great. There are some great site-based councils. So,
yeah.
And right now, also another issue is that we would like for the parents to have more of an equal voice. Right now, parents really aren't encouraged to run for the site-based council seats.
They don't do a good job promoting it even here.
Right, and they don't really anywhere. No. So, and we looked at some of the turnouts, and like at some schools, it's just like 1%. No, yeah. It's just like really low. Yeah. So if they were equalized, okay, where you had equal number of parents on the board, we think that would help in some areas. And again, we're not talking about every site-based council having problems, but we are saying that without this change in the policy,
it needs to be uniform.
Yeah, it needs to be. And parents need to have an option. You know, if they're not going to have an equal voice on the council, they need to be able to go to the board and say, I've got a problem. The other issue we found out was that there are all these crazy rules in place about a board member not coming to being able to come to a site-based council. Yeah. And I think that's wrong. Okay. If you're going to hold, and here's why. If you're going to hold a person accountable, you're going to elect them, they're going to run on here's what we're going to do, and you're going to hold them accountable, they need to at least be able to attend the meeting and I think express their views.
Yeah, I'm not going to go with you on that.
Okay.
And let me explain to you.
Okay.
You know, I don't just arbitrarily argue with you. I always have some out there point. But what I have found before it became a big deal and I had to step up and say don't do it, even though, you know, before you just sort of overlook things and let it happen, I have seen where board members went and tried to run the meeting as a board member. At that point, they've stepped across at least the intention of what we do. Now, if they want to go and be an observer and offer information, heck yes.
But they're not even allowed to do that.
No.
And so, so I think you're right. No, I agree with you. I don't think a board member should run the meeting.
No.
Okay. However, we had some crazy things. The Office of Education Accountability, which I wish they would do what they're really there. They could do a lot of good. But they came down on board members, like there was a board member in Lexington, a couple of ones, that simply expressed an opinion about a school, how they wish they would improve, and they got sanctioned by the OEA for doing that, which I think is wrong.
So. I wish the OEA go to sleep.
Yeah.
The,
or else wake up fully.
One of the things that I'll say before I get to my point.
Okay.
And you can respond, and then I'll get to my point. When all this started, it was required by law that they publicly advertise the site-based elections. You could either mail a letter to every available person to vote, or you could run a legal. It showed who was running, when the vote was, and where. I don't believe that's followed anywhere.
That may still be on the books.
And if it is, that is something that you can find that out for me and let me know, and I'll editorialize about that. I frankly believe...
Maybe you'll run my column if I like.
Hey! Yeah. But I wanted to step back when we were talking about the aluminum industry at 40% and some of the things that you pointed out. Rocky Atkins, I had him on in the regional tournament, and he's one of the gubernatorial candidates. Do you know that the largest industry in Kentucky is the aerospace industry?
Yeah.
And it's Moorhead has that aerospace center, and they've done some unbelievable.
Yeah.
I mean, people want to look at us and call us rural eastern Kentucky. Hey, they have plenty of smart people here, too. They're everywhere.
Oh, absolutely. No,
they have the Kraft Academy, and then you have the Gatton Academy down where you are.
And you know, Hank.
That's choice.
Those are choices. And I find it interesting, don't you, that a few years ago, and the Gatton Academy has been ranked the number one high school in America by U.S. News and World Report several times. So we had this situation, though, where we had this school of choice, and there wasn't any legal enabling legislation for it. Well, then Speaker Jody Richards, that's his district,
right,
got legislation passed allowing that one school, at that time, that was before the Kraft school started, but allowing that one school to operate. Well, if we're going to do that for those kids, why can't we give the same options across the state? And look how successful that's been. They come on campus, they get a tremendous education. And you know, what I really love about the people, they don't even really like to trumpet their own horns. You know, I said, you need to blow this horn as loud. But they have done an excellent, outstanding job of educating kids. And people have a choice. And you know, nobody's forced to do it. Nobody's forced to do it.
Right.
You know, they come because they want to be there, you know. And
well, you know, I know Tim Rhodes. I don't know if you know Tim. He's at Moorhead. We've been friends for I don't know, 30 years maybe. And he put together this marvelous team.
Yeah.
And these kids, they so overperform. I mean, yeah. I've got friends here who have children that go there. In fact, one works for the school district. But the opportunity to expand that math and science, and it's not, I mean, Russell scores, you know that, scores way high, Raceland scores way high in those areas. But this is almost a vocational approach to education.
But we did some work on Greenham County, by the way, and the ACT scores here are lower than the national average.
Not at Russell.
So, as a district. As a
How
district.
Is it Russell?
At Greenham.
Greenham County
schools. So I then look at
Russell. But Sherry's retiring.
I'm not being critical,
that she and her administrative staff have really worked toward a career and ready.
And here's the thing. All I'm saying about the only thing I'm saying is, I think by offering choices, and charter schools, remember, are public schools.
Right.
So they're how they perform matters to a public school
sure.
district.
They're going to be accountable.
They can tell. And with the aerospace, look at you make a great point with aerospace industry. They're going to be hungry for people coming that are math and science proficient.
Right.
Proficient.
Not even distinguished, just
be proficient.
Be proficient.
Be proficient. And a lot of these places are going to provide their own additional education, their own additional training. And so for us, it's not about, and you have some great public schools.
I'm just saying.
For the kids that it doesn't work for, and you have to acknowledge
right.
it doesn't work for everybody. Well, why don't, I know there are a lot of administrators out here and teachers who do care about, and they would say, if we're having a conversation, give the kids whatever is best for them, whatever
sure.
we need to do.
Yeah.
And I love that. And what we're finding is even lots of public school teachers are sending their children to the school that works best for them. I think it should be for everybody.
Well, it's not an issue of embarrassing the district you work for.
Right.
It is an issue of
what's best for that
what's
child.
Best for the child.
Yeah.
And you know what? If they go there and they spend a year and they don't perform, not as a punishment, but if it is no
right.
better,
right.
then you bring them back.
Right.
You know.
And there are parents who do that.
Yes.
Or like in Kentucky, one of the few choices parents have had in some districts is the inter-district transfer agreements.
Yes.
The problem with that is both school boards have to sign the agreement, both superintendents.
Yeah, we're having trouble with that here.
So what we're going to suggest is it's working because we know down in Murray there are 900 kids, 900 at last count,
right.
that were sending their children to the Murray Independent because they're so much higher performing.
Oh, I know.
And now they're willing to pay tuition
sure.
to send their children to a public school. Nobody should have to pay tuition to send their children to a public school,
no.
right? So let's fix it. And look, that's public education working. That's choice in public education.
Right.
Charter schools are public education working. So I'm talking here about things that will work for Kentucky, you know, not something that'll just work for another state or even in a city. These things will work for all around, and I'm excited about that. And I think there's going to be more and more people. I've been excited about retired superintendents who've said, hey, you know, we've looked at this. It's something we need to consider. Teachers who are in the classroom, who are innovative thinking, people who are thinking innovatively are going to say, this isn't about the adults. This isn't about satisfying the adults. This is about what's best for the kids. And the amazing thing about that is, let's take California. That's not a conservative state. That's a liberal political state for the most part. They've got 900 charter schools out there, some of them online. And guess what? It gives teachers another option, too. If they want to teach in that setting, it gives them opportunities.
Right.
So it's good for the kids. It's good for the teachers. It's good for the state.
It's good for the people.
It's good for the people. Yeah.
Right.
It's good for the people. What did Abraham Lincoln say? For the people.
For the people.
Yeah. So.
Well, I know Doug Buchanan's the new superintendent in Nicholas County, and his slogan is "Every Child, Every Day."
There you go. And you were talking about earlier about the gentleman at Kraft, you know, put together
right.
the great team.
Tim Rhodes.
We sent 15 black pastors and retired educators, all of them African Americans, to Milwaukee and Philadelphia. We worked with the Friedman Foundation. We funded the whole trip. They got their airfare, everything. We sent them everything so they could go see. Because sometimes I can sit here and tell you, right? But there is no substitute for you. You've seen what's going on at Kraft.
That can be done all over our state. And they saw it. They went to the inner city and they saw larger size classrooms, 35 and 40 kids, well-behaved in charter schools in the inner city, in some cases with their own laptops. They're closing the gaps in academic achievement. They're outperforming their peers. Here's another thing for you. Property values are improving in the inner cities because of these choices. People are moving back into those places where they left. These things are not done in a vacuum. And you know what? I think with Brady coming here, I think with what's going to happen in this area, I think it's critically important that we have as many options for our kids as possible. And that does not take anything at all away from what is the good things being done now, you know?
Right.
And we've given out Diamonds in the Rough Award to school districts that we felt like had great ideas and they were getting started with them. You know, we want to encourage that because it's good for the kids.
I will close our show by saying that what the entire concept of education needs is an increase and an enforcement of academic expectations.
Expectations huge. And all of the charter schools in the inner city that those pastors went to, they came back and I asked them, what did you learn?
Right.
And I thought, I was expecting some deep, you know what they said? That we found out that poor black kids can learn.
Right.
They can learn. You know why? Because the teacher expects them to learn. What you expect, you get. Think about it. What you expect from your employees, what you expect from your fellow workers, what you expect from your students. Why not raise the bar, right?
Right.
Why do we look at a poor child and say they can't learn? I know better than that. And right. It's not just poor black. That's just what they saw, right?
Right.
But they said poor children can learn.
Right.
You know?
So, Jim,
thank you. It's been great to be here.
Jim Waters with the Blue Gas
Thanks
Institute.
For lunch, by the way.
Yeah, I'm going to buy his lunch now.
I'm going to get steak.
I'm safe. They don't sell it. And we appreciate Jim. He'll be back again next year.
Thank you.
After the legislature meets, we'll invite him back in probably April or May so that we can talk about the success and failure of the legislations and what we can work on for the next year. And just so you know, Jim and I will always be friends.
Even though we started out saying we were enemies.
Well, political enemies. You know, I can't help you. But anyway, he is...
No help.
He's a wealth of information. Even if he's wrong, I can't help it. Misdirected, you know. Thanks, Jim.
Thanks.
This is Greena Beacon Video News Magazine, a presentation of First and People's Bank and the Greena Beacon Media Network. Thanks for joining us here on greenupbeacon.com and Facebook Live.
Around the corner or around the world with the Green Up Beacon.